Sorry. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this crypto asset bubble session, which is developed in partnership with Yicai Media Group. As the price of the Bitcoin soared by 13-fold in 2017 with extreme volatility, Bitcoin emerges from the underground world of nerds and criminals to become a mainstream investment today. And from today, there are close to 1,000 different crypto assets on the market, and also the combined market value of the cryptocurrencies surged to 540 billion. And the blockchain technology that underpins it has become impossible for the big financial institutions to ignore. So are these crypto assets finally coming into their own, or are they bubbles, fraud, Ponzi scheme, index of money laundering, or is the seed of the next financial crisis, and maybe even worse? So recently, the central bank have entered the fray with several announcing that they are exploring or experimenting CBDC, which is central banking digital currency, with blockchain and also other technologies. And because today, technology developers and investors and regulators and central bankers see crypto assets in different ways, and few people can ever be on the same page. So I have a very big ambition today to for our session that I hope we can help chart the future paths for Bitcoin, crypto assets, ICO, and blockchain technology all together. And I, you will be a little bit skeptical for me, but I do have this big ambition because we have a big and we have very good panel today. And so let me introduce them very briefly. To my left, Mr. Neil Rimmer, and he is the general partner and co-founder of the Index Ventures in Switzerland. And next to him, Jennifer Zhu Scott. She is the principal of the Reading Partners in Hong Kong, and also she is a young global leader. And next to her, Professor Robert Schiller, and everyone knows you. He is the Sterling Professor of Economics and in Yale University in the United States. And last but not least, Cecilien Skinsley. She's the Deputy Governor of the Swedish Central Bank, in which name is Swedish Risk Bank. Yep. I'm not sure am I right or not. Close. Yeah, in Sweden.
Very good.
Yeah, welcome so much. Thank you very much. And before we start the debate and dialogue, can I do a very quick poll? Just I learned from the Jenny yesterday. Are you pro or against Bitcoin? Pro.
Can I be halfway?
Can we do pause?
You can. You can. And against? No. Okay.
Well,
and what about you? Are you a pro Bitcoin?
All right.
Mm-hmm. And how many of you are against Bitcoin? Mm-hmm. Oh, only a few of you. Great. It's the starting
we
point.
We should see, we can do this again in an hour.
Of course.
Time
right, exactly. Exactly what I mean. Exactly, yeah. So my first question is for Professor Schiller. As a Nobel Prize laureate and also the world's best economist on asset bubble and behavioral finance, and you are among the first group of the economists who blame Bitcoin as a big bubble there. And in your view, how do you assess the fundamental value of the Bitcoin? Do you think that the Bitcoin, ETH, and the Ripples will replace a large fraction of the conventional money someday?
Okay, maybe I can step back and put some historical perspective.
Sure.
There have been repeated proposals to change the currency. Very interesting proposal came in 1879 from Simon Newcomb, the famous astronomer who was reacting to the instability of the gold standard. And he proposed something called the compensated dollar, which is paper money backed by gold, but the gold content of the dollar is constantly changed by a monetary authority to keep the buying power absolutely constant. Neat idea. It was talked about for a long time. Never happened, okay? Another neat idea. In Chile, in 1967, they introduced a new unit of account called the Unidad de Fomento, again, aiming at stability. This Unidad de Fomento is a daily interpolated Chilean consumer price index. There's a website, unidaddefomento.something. You can look at it. You can make payments now in that. It's an electronic system. And it had a good foundation. The funny thing is, it only spread geographically. Mexico has the Unidad de Inversión. There are other Latin American countries. So the spread of these ideas, although they're good ideas, seems to me to have like a geographical or epidemic nature to it. Bitcoin is another really clever idea. I'm impressed with the technology. And it is spreading in certain quarters. There are certain kinds of people who love this. But it doesn't, in my mind, it seems to me it's technology for something else. It's gone viral as a currency. And the blockchain is important, but it's not going to be stable. And so I think, you asked me whether I'm for it or against it. I am for the Unidad de Fomento, and I will argue that every country should adopt what Chile has invented. And maybe we don't do that because we're not in the habit of listening to Chile, or we don't like the story or the sound of how it came about. But there are other ideas. And so I tend to think of Bitcoin as an experiment. It's an interesting experiment. It's not a permanent feature of our lives. We're overemphasizing Bitcoin. We should broaden it out to crypto, toward blockchain, which will have other applications.
But in Chile's case, the underlying technology is different from the technology in the Bitcoin, which is blockchain. Yes.
It still is digital now. I mean, you
yeah, it is digital, but still different.
A website to.
Okay.
And it has real value. Let me say, in any other country in the world, there's inflation. You are a renter. You pay a rent which is fixed during the year and change maybe once a year, or then there's this nuisance of changing it. So that means that the real value of the rent you pay has a jagged sawtooth pattern. Every year it goes down until it suddenly goes up again. That's a dumb idea. Why do we still do it? In Chile, they've got it worked out. You do your rent in UFs, Unidad de Fomento, and it's absolutely stable. Why aren't we imitating that?
Okay. Then you haven't answered my question. Do you think that down the road, the Bitcoin will occupy the more and more share of the payment and the money share we have today? And also, Governor maybe want to answer this question too.
Well, yeah, I don't think it's big on payments. You agree on that?
I think to define Bitcoin as a cryptocurrency.
But in the first place, do you think it's a currency or it's not a currency?
I think it's a very lousy currency. I don't think it's a payment. It's a very lousy payment. I don't think Bitcoin is disrupting currency or money. Bitcoin is disrupting gold. If you think about what gold as reserve is doing today, Bitcoin can do that and do that better. And I couldn't help.
So you mean it's an asset instead of currency, but
it's a
governor,
value.
Do you agree with Professor Schiller?
I represent the conventional issuers of money, which is central banking. Money, if you think about it, I'm not going to go. I'll do a little bit of history as well. So money is a social convention that mankind has come up with to facilitate a store of value and facilitate a medium of exchange. Otherwise, we would go into barter trading, and that's horribly inefficient.
And also,
have moved from gold to in Sweden we were poor, so we used copper, and we have evolved into paper notes, and now we have the greater part of conventional money. Fiat money is actually produced by the commercial banks, but it starts with a central bank version of money. But in order for money to be defined as good money, efficient money, it has to be a store of value that is pretty stable, at least in consumption, from a consumer's a stable consumer perspective. So inflation must be have price stability,
yeah.
And there has to be enough people are prepared to accept that version of money in a country or in a currency union, etc. So in my view, cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin and the others, the way I've seen them so far, they don't meet the criteria for be called money. They can be called an asset, fine, but they are not a very good version of money because it's not a very stable store of value. They fluctuate a lot. And it's not a very efficient medium of exchange because you don't buy your groceries with Bitcoin or you don't get your salaries in Bitcoin, and you can certainly not pay your taxes in Bitcoin. There you still have to use the conventional versions of money.
Yeah, but Japan government defined Bitcoin as a currency.
I've heard about that too, but you still, as a taxpayer in Japan, have to pay your taxes in yen, and that is the critical factor that creates the great externality effects that makes a money efficient in an economy.
Yeah. So Jennifer, I'm sorry to cut you. And do you agree with the professor? And do you agree with the governor, please?
I disagree.
Which part?
First of all, I pick up what professor said. There are certain type of people, pick up Bitcoin. I can be more specific what type of people. The type of people who are a little bit rebel, the type of people who think, let's all talk about history. The first central bank was created in Sweden in 1668. And for 350 years, we have central banks have unchallenged the authority to issue money, and you earn that money, and the money is inflationary. Bitcoin is deflationary. Bitcoin is completely mathematically metered.
Deflation is a problem, similar with the gold. So we abandon the gold standard.
So if you use currency, I might agree, but if you use Bitcoin as store of value, why would I earn my hard-earned money through my hard work and next year will worth less? Right? That's what happened with the fiat currency.
Yeah.
But with the Bitcoin, there are only totally in the world that will ever be 21 million Bitcoins. So the value to create more value has to be deflationary. So as a store of value, I think Bitcoin is a very, very efficient. And either people like you or not, it's not going to go away.
But what if there's a collapse of the price of the Bitcoin sometime, maybe this year or next year?
Doesn't
then
matter.
What do we about the storage of the value if you want to keep the value? But maybe, please.
I mean, currencies have collapsed many times.
Yeah. Many times,
but they
right.
come back, right? And just so, I mean.
But maybe not Bitcoin, maybe another currency, because the latest news that some kind of rating agency rating the Bitcoin and some other cryptocurrencies, and their conclusion is that the Bitcoin is not a good one. But it's still, the price is very, very high.
I would argue that, and first of all, I'm very uncomfortable disagreeing with a Nobel Prize winning economist on anything. So you can feel free to overrule anything I'll say. But what I would say is that, the reason I'm for this is that I'm an investor in technology and innovation, and I think this is one of the most audacious, generous, and profound inventions that we've witnessed, that certainly I've witnessed in my career. And it does have the ability to help many, many people. Mm-hmm. But we're 9 years into this experiment. Mm. And the experiment has gone well at times and more poorly. Right now it looks like it's working. But it has by no means succeeded. And it could fail completely and go to zero and lose people's confidence. But it has accomplished a number of things that I think are remarkable. It's completely trustworthy, with no central authority or entity controlling it. A distributed ledger.
It's a strength or a problem? Think about the security
issue. It depends
issue.
Who you are.
Think about the hack issue.
Right. So, it can't solve all problems. I think the problem it really is trying to solve is being exposed to currencies that are moved around at the whim of governments who may or may not know what they're doing or may not have your interests at heart. The people I know, when you talk about people who own Bitcoin, are some very, very, I know some very, very smart, educated, rational people who grew up in Argentina and witnessed their parents going to the supermarket with shopping bags full of currency and spending it all in one day because they're worried that the next day it would be worth less.
Yeah.
For them, they don't have a lot of faith in the Argentinian government's ability to defend a currency, maintain its value. And they also like the idea of it being transportable. So when you talk about somebody using an unidad de fermento, what happens if they cross the border? You know, what about refugees? What about people in Iran or in camps in Turkey? So it's a very convenient, reassuring way of storing value. Mm-hmm. Sure, it's super volatile. It's actually quite inconvenient to use. Mm-hmm. And there have been many issues with it, related not so much to Bitcoin, but to the exchanges and to the wallets that you have to use, which are kind of hacked together and not particularly convenient. Mm-hmm. So it's still a hobbyist thing. But as I say, we're only 9 years into this thing, and it's still trusted, and it's still doing what it set out to do, which I find really remarkable.
Yeah, I think Anil and Jennifer raise a very important point, is that the authority and money authority, some monetary authority or all money authorities on this world, is not that trustworthy because they issue too much money. Mm-hmm. Governor, do you agree with them?
Can't talk for all the central bankers of the world through history. I think there is a point there that in countries, I mean, money is a trust, and if you give out too much of it, you cause inflation, or if you give out too little of it, you cause deflation, and that hurts people. And mankind, as I said before, has been struggling with this for thousands of years. You have agreed about gold, it had an intrinsic value. If it fell apart with inflation, you could always melt it down and start over again. And then for the last 300-400 years, we have used more and more of paper notes, and then we have gone into the digital banking system. And I understand there are countries where you don't trust the public authorities, and you see this as an alternative. I think it's a very poor alternative, to be honest, given that it's too volatile to be used as money. I have no problems if people want to invest in it and use it as an asset. I mean, you can use anything that other people agree has a value, you can do that. But if you're talking about money in an efficient economy over time, it's much better if you have a trustworthy authority that issues enough money, not too little and not too much. And the way it works now in most central banks, and there are exceptions, I agree, is that we don't connect the money, the amount of money we issue and the price we put it to gold, but we have something else. We have the law. The law is the gold of modern central banking, and the laws in most countries now say you should give out money and put the price on money or the interest rate to the extent that you cause price stability, which is roughly 1-3%, because you have to allow for relative price changes. That's how it works. And it has worked tremendously well in most countries. But if you get it wrong, you get it wrong. But you also got it wrong. You will get it wrong in the cryptocurrency world as well. If there are too much of us interest holding this versus how much will be issued, so that is the challenge we all have to face when we are in the money business.
I think at this stage we have some consensus that the Bitcoin is more asset instead of a currency.
Yes.
But if it is good asset, shall we regulate it, Professor Schiller?
I was impressed when I visited Lithuania recently. Small talk that I had there with some Bitcoin enthusiasts. Someone said in early 1940s, Lithuania was annexed by the Soviet Union. And they said, do you know what happened to you if you owned a house and you had a portfolio of investments in Lithuania? Well, they probably took it. They defined you as a capitalist tool or something, and they took it. Not only that, but they sent you to Siberia as well. If you had had Bitcoin back then, they couldn't have taken it. That led me to stop and think, really? You know, I don't trust foreign governments taking over, but those things have actually happened in recent history. On the other hand, I think you would have probably lost your Bitcoin too, right? If all those things happened, you would lose your computer and it would be gone. So maybe the whole premise. I don't have the full story of what we're...
I think you wouldn't lose it if you keep your private key as long as you can access to internet.
You have to memorize it then? Or?
You can memorize your private key. You can memorize your...
Does anybody do that?
Of course. And people putting their private key into a safe. You know, a lot of people now, they use a hardware wallet to keep their crypto assets and keep their private key into a safe. And I think, you know, in future, a lot of private banks, one of the services they can provide to their clients is to keep the private key of their digital assets. And I think, you know, in terms of, we keep referring back, you know, Bitcoin as a currency or asset. It reminds me, perhaps this conversation 10 years down the road will sound a little bit like when we say MySpace doesn't really work, therefore internet probably won't work, right? So I think this is,
Now we have WeChat.
And now we have WeChat, because we have to realize this is an infancy stage of a potentially multi-decade project. And the technology right now is not perfect. I don't argue for a second that, you know, crypto assets right now are all perfect. But you asking, you know, where Bitcoin price gonna be? To me, I have Bitcoin.
Hold on, please. I will ask you later on.
I will give you my 2 cents on that. But the point I was trying to make is that pricing of Bitcoin, since the first time I read Satoshi Nakamoto's white paper, I realized pricing of Bitcoin.
Have you met him?
I wish. I was joking this morning. I think President Trump tomorrow probably going to announce that he's Satoshi. Quite possibly.
Is he that smart?
He's the smartest guy in the world.
Maybe in a different way.
So back to my point, I think we overemphasize Bitcoin's pricing. I think that's really misleading, because the fact that, you know, people keep talking of Bitcoin today is below 10,000, it's disaster, or above 10,000, it's crazy. I actually think the fact that Bitcoin's still alive still attracts so much attention. The fact that we're talking about Bitcoin in Davos with Nobel Prize winner, central bank governor, and seasoned investors.
Yeah, I think it's very good. But in your mind,
it means it's a powerful idea.
Right, yeah. But which is your favorite cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, ETH, or Ripple?
I have them all. I don't have Ripple. I have them all.
why don't you have Ripple? Because the price so low?
No, I think you know, one of the spirit of people who came into this space and the very early on, that they knew we exchanged a little bit about this, is that decentralization, right? Satoshi, you know, invented the Bitcoin protocol in that, you know, ashes of 2008 financial crisis, when everybody lost their faith in central bank. And so he created this decentralized, you know, peer-to-peer payment. He really intended to be a payment system.
Yeah.
Invented this peer-to-peer payment system really is to establish some peer-to-peer economy central bank.
Do you mean that do you hint that the Bitcoins can self-regulate themselves? There's no need of the regulation at all?
Okay, this is a very good question, right? We keep comparing Bitcoin with US dollar. Let me say this. Behind Bitcoin, there's no Bitcoin central bank. There's no Bitcoin Inc. CEO overpaid, and when it's crashed and ask taxpayers' money to bail it out. Bitcoin behind it, you know, there's no centralized institution behind Bitcoin, you know, borrow $200 billion, you know, debt.
Right. So just in short, is more trust or less trust?
I think
lack of the central
bank. I must protest here. you're saying that people don't trust central banks anymore. Let me get you an example of how at least they trust the central bank and the money in Sweden. The number of transactions in Bitcoin is 1/30th of the number of transactions done by cards, which is a proxy for central bank money through the banking system in Sweden. So it can be an asset. I think we can agree on that. I also think we can agree on that the technology is promising, but it is not a very well-spread payment method. So a lot of people, most people and most transactions in the world are still done with conventional currencies issued by central banks.
What about regulation?
And I understand that there are people who have different views,
right.
But we still have a very competitive product.
Can I comment on regulation?
Please, regulation, first.
So I actually do think it needs to be regulated, because I think it needs to be regulated, just like anything that I would want to become mainstream needs to be regulated. It needs to exist in society and can't be, there can't be this huge overhang over it promises to change everything because a regulator decides this is no longer cool. And by the way, this is the same story of any fintech innovation, and the best ones have always done things that were a little bit beyond the boundaries of the current regulatory framework, but they've done it in a responsible way, and they've actually gone and asked the regulator to take a look at what they're doing. Mm-hmm. The UK, for instance, was, I think, admirable in creating this sandbox to allow them to play and do limited damage if things don't work, assuming that they were trying to do something of value. I think that there will be object lessons, and I do think this is kind of one of the things I worry about. And actually, referring to one of the talks I saw you give, Professor, about narratives, mm-hmm. I do believe a government will probably come down very hard on a cryptocurrency and make it a lesson. What I would love to see is for there to be a role model where somebody actually takes an application and works with a government and does something that corresponds to a certain regulatory framework. But this can only be done in one country at a time. Nobody can regulate all of Bitcoin. You can regulate the use of Bitcoin in your country or in your group of countries, but.
Now, which country in your mind?
I think the most forward-thinking countries should probably do this. So countries,
England?
Perhaps the U.S., perhaps Sweden.
Yeah, possible. Then back to the regulation. You are very right that we need to regulate the thing that becomes a mainstream investment target. But at the same time, the question is, the sandbox will not solve the problem. Mm-hmm. Who is going to regulate the Bitcoin ICOs? And how to regulate the ICOs and Bitcoins?
Mm-hmm. Well, there are already regulations in place here. That's important to remember.
Some of them.
So if you see it as an asset, which most countries do, there is investor protection legislation, consumer protection legislation.
You mean the ICO?
There has been some authorities clamping down on platforms.
Yes, that's about ICO.
And if you use it for illegal transactions, if you're involved in drug dealing, anti-money laundering, financing terrorists, you will be hunted by the authorities, independent of if you pay in dollars or in bitcoins or in cupcakes or whatever you use.
But the problem is that you cannot regulate Bitcoin today in terms of the money laundering, in terms of
terrorism. No, but it's
the
activity that is going to be clamped down, independent of which currency you use.
Yeah, Jennifer.
I think the regulation is really in the past few months, even it's quite more and more clear. So you can apart from China, right? China had a hard stop in terms of the.
Do you think China made a mistake?
I think for China's where China is right now, perhaps China needs to give a hard stop in terms of ICOs, right? But in over longer term, we keep hearing that PBOC has been contemplating issuing state-issued blockchain-powered cryptocurrency. I can see why.
You mean the CBDC?
Central bank.
You mean the central banking digital currency?
Yes.
Okay. So we'll talk about that later.
With that, I think it's actually very valuable for PBOC, right? You can have perfect capital control, right? You can have perfect, taxing tax system to collect the tax, right? But back to the point, Governor, I actually don't think central bank people don't trust the central bank completely anymore. But what I find very, very valuable for, you know, the gift from Satoshi to the world is to, for many, many years, we just assume that money should come from central bank. But because of Bitcoin, because of cryptocurrency, it really provoked a lot of people start to think, what is money? Where money should come from? How much our money should be appreciated or depreciated? I think that kind of debate is healthy.
Yeah, very good. And also, very quick question for Jennifer. Do you have trust in monetary authority in Hong Kong?
I do. I use fiat currency every day, but I also want a part of my portfolio, I want some of my assets has zero correlation to central bank policy, and which is cryptocurrencies providing
right
now. So it's
an investment portfolio kind of thinking.
Diversification.
Yeah,
but
understand.
Also, I think, you know, in terms of tokens, right now you can issue security token or utility token. Utility token pretty much, apart from China's hard stop, but pretty much every country self-regulate. If you issue security token, pretty much every country will either have existing security laws to govern your security token, or their central bank has issued very clear, you know, indication in terms of how you regulate security token.
Right. Professor, please.
Relating to regulation, I was recently involved in discussion with the Chicago Mercantile Exchange about creating a futures market. Now, regulators had to approve the futures market in Bitcoin. And I think that was only last month that happened. I initially opposed the idea.
Uh-huh.
I'm not quite to your level of enthusiasm.
I think the media maybe misrepresented you a little bit.
Yeah, sometimes
please,
that happens.
Go ahead.
But the thing is that what struck me about this is that it was possible to short Bitcoin via some of the exchanges.
Difficult.
It has been difficult to short. And financial theory says if something is not shortable, then it can be taken over by enthusiasts. And the doubters no longer have an adequate way of betting against it. So we've just seen both the CBO and the CME have both created futures markets for Bitcoin. And that might make it more stable. Now, in fact, when people ask me, should I invest in Bitcoin, I have a follow-up question. Long or short, what are you thinking of? And I can't really know with certainty
which is
the right
one. What is your view, long or short at this moment?
I would say long, but not more than you can afford to lose completely, because it's an experiment, and we want the experiment to succeed. But one sure way of making it fail is if too many people lose their life savings, then it will go to zero because they'll sell the rest.
Yeah, and also hold for your.
Hold,
yeah,
but at the same time, also think, you know, let's be honest, right? Right now, there are about more than 1,000 cryptocurrencies available in the market right now. I would say 1995, perhaps even higher number of those cryptocurrencies would not be around in 3 years' time, because a lot of those companies took this window of opportunities, issued their token with a very simple business mm-hmm. idea and put into a white paper. So essentially, they are using seed stage VC angel stage business proposal to seek IPO level of fundraising. And I think that's not going to end well. Now, another thing is I have to give some feedback to media. I think media right
very
now...
Very briefly, please.
I think media right now overly focus on the pricing and not paying...
Actually, we are not. You mentioned the central bank digital currency. We have just published an article from the deputy governor of the PBOC, mm-hmm. and he declared that the forward thinking of the CBDC plan in China by the PBOC. And you talk about the blockchain technology.
Right.
But according to the plan from the PBOC, they said that maybe we are not going to use the blockchain as the technology for the CBDC in their plan. So, Governor, you also have an e-corona plan. So what kind of technology are you going
to
utilize?
So I'll talk a little bit about that. So it has a different, completely starting point, the research project we run at the Riksbank. And the starting point we have is that technologically and legally, it become very easy in Sweden to live completely cashless. And there is no legal obligation for banks or for shops to take notes and coins. And it's very easy to use cards and instant payment apps. So We see a rapid decrease in the value of circulation in notes and coins. And as a central bank, we are sort of neutral about this. We think that people should be able to use the payment methods that they find safe and efficient, as long as they're safe and efficient. However, going from a non-cash society into a potential non-cash society, where notes and coins are no longer useful as a store of value, well, it can still be a store of value, but not as a medium of exchange, is a new society. And it opens up a number of intricate questions, such as, can we still say as a central bank that we provide a safe and efficient payment system? Is it accessible for everybody? Because in reality, it means that everybody has to be a part of the commercial banking system. And not everybody wants to be a part of the commercial banking system or are not even allowed into it. So that is the starting point. We have to look at the consequences of a cashless society. Is it still safe and efficient if we go in there? And if we find that there is a need for a public sector digital version, we are looking into what sort of features that would have. And that is what we call potentially an e-krona. And it's far away into the future. It's not something that we are doing near. And no, we don't know if we're going to use blockchain or any other technology. But it would work as a one-to-one exchange rate versus the krona that we have, which is the national currency, and it would potentially work as a complement to the notes and coins that we provide, so that people also in the future will be able to choose whether they want to have a claim on the commercial bank having the deposits there, or if they want to have a claim on the central bank. They can have it now with the notes, but then potentially they can also have it in the future.
Governor, very quickly, do you think the CBDC in Sweden will be M1, M2, or M0? I'm sorry, too academic.
Yeah, no, that's a good question. So that would be a digital version of cash. So the answer is it would be M0.
Zero.
The nearest version of money.
And also, do you think it should be retailing or wholesaling? Means, shall we need banking sector or we don't need them anymore?
So the reason for why we started this project was that we see that individuals are stop using cash, or the banks and shops stop accepting and offer cash services. If there is a need, it would be offered to individuals primarily.
I see. Then will it be anonymous or not?
So that is one of the questions that where the staff is looking into. My personal view is that it's perhaps not the core business of the public sector to facilitate illegal transactions. So at the end of the day, it would probably be necessary for be able to look into transactions in an e-krona for criminal investigation reasons. But it's a political issue, and we leave that to the legislators to look into potentially.
When will we see the CBDC in Sweden?
I don't know. It's a long way to go, I think.
Okay.
But we have to do the homework, since cash is going out of fashion very quickly.
Right. Jennifer, your view on the CBDC?
I think, it's in fact, I don't think, completely outside of central bank system, a very efficient, very efficient payment system will really exist, because I don't think any country, any sovereign country, any central bank will allow there's another alternative currency completely outside of central bank's oversight. However, I do think that we haven't mentioned the term token economy, right? We focus on, if cryptocurrencies is going to replace money or not, or if it's a store of value or not. However, I think, if you look a little bit beyond of the manic, happening in the cryptocurrency.
You mean the technology?
I think the technology now create this kind of very effective, very efficient micro-incentive system that will potentially disrupt venture capital. We are, in fact, disrupting ourselves, potentially will disrupt IPO market, right? And I think financial market, I have been invested in fintech for a number of years, and over the years, I have seen many companies that always building on the same system, just incrementally make it a little bit more efficient, a little bit more transparent. But with blockchain, the underlying underlying technology is
by the way, let me ask you a very specific question. Do you think the blockchain technology can replace the RTGS system in the banking sector we are using today for the payment system?
I think the scalability is not there yet.
Okay.
But over time, give it time, right? This is infancy stage.
How long?
It's hard to say that the acceleration is happening very fast. So I think the breakthrough could happen anytime.
Neil, please.
Yeah, no, so a couple of things to comment on. I mean, the first is, you know, tokens and their use in delivering other functions than just transactions or store of value, which is the primary function of the Bitcoin blockchain. I do think that's interesting. And so if you think of notaries or, you know, or title insurance, you know, things that require some sort of a stamp and a lot of bureaucracy. It's quite conceivable to think of a blockchain with a token that's used to verify those transactions and to store them forever in an inviolable way. But that's still, you know, I think it's a bit easy to sort of say that the blockchain will generate lots of things, and we're not so sure about Bitcoin. The truth is, you need one with the other, because you need these
totally.
This way of giving people incentives to do all the work to verify this distributed database. I mean, two people running two computers is not as trustworthy as thousands of people doing this, right? So I think you can't sort of buy into it, but not completely buy into it. You do have to buy into the idea that these things will be valuable. Now, what does that do to venture capital and, you know, and our business of investing in the equity of startups and helping them grow their business? I think that, as it's been pointed out, there's a lot of volatility and there's a gold rush, and lots of people just think, why wouldn't I buy Bitcoin? It only goes one way. And that clearly cannot last, and that will not last. And so that's attracted lots of people into the market, and lots of, I think, unethical offerings of tokens, and those things will hopefully be regulated out of business or just shut down. On the other hand, I don't think that every business can fund itself by monetizing some unit of exchange in their future business by selling tokens and not by selling equity. You know, if you think of something like Kickstarter, mm-hmm. I think of Kickstarter as kind of a proto ICO, in the sense that, you know, Kickstarter, the site where you can show some product mm-hmm. And sell it, you make a nice video that describes the product, hopefully something that you will actually make,
yeah.
And people will give you orders, actually give you the money, buy it beforehand, and you're funding your business without yeah. selling equity.
Yeah. So before we open the floor, let me ask Neil and Jennifer very quickly one question about ICO. Why China government shut down all the Bitcoin exchanges and all the ICO? Because according to one survey in China, 90% of the ICO scheme is a cheating scheme and cheating case. So that's the reason why the China government moves very quickly to stop everything. But how is the situation in other places, in your view? Mm. ICOs.
I don't think China has a monopoly on that. I think there are a lot of people who are taking advantage of this gold rush, and the fact that and the people are not doing their homework and just buying things without asking themselves what's going on. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the whole thing will come crashing down.
Jennifer?
I think, you know, first of all, you don't need ICO to tokenize. Tokenization doesn't really require ICO. ICO is a marketing process, right? Secondly, I think there's a ripple effect in terms of central bank's action and the regulator's action, because in the past probably 7-8 months, I have spoken to governments from Oman to Switzerland. Last week, I just met Switzerland's federal council, who's in charge of economy. And after the meeting with a group of us, he actually announced that he wants to make Switzerland a crypto nation.
Yeah.
In Asia, Cambodia, Bangladesh, et cetera, a lot of smaller economy now, they started to think, you know, if we just make our regulation a little bit more crypto friendly, perhaps we can attract a lot of capital and a lot of talent. And either you like it or not, I think we are really and the cost of something quite extraordinary happening in terms of monetary reset. In the history, every time there was a big disruptive technology taking over, what followed with that is always a monetary reset from railway to internet. But now with the information technology, we've already at the end of probably 25 years. Yeah. If you think about how seamless everything else using technology, and then you think about our financial system, there is a mismatch. So who's there to say things not going to be completely different, right? Yeah. And I think in the 90s, when people talking with early investors going to internet, they always say, "Oh, intranet will probably take off." But internet, can't imagine and people.
Sometimes we need bubbles to nurture the new technology.
Absolutely.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, it strikes me that what bothers me about Bitcoin is that the enthusiasm I see is like a speculative bubble. It's about somebody made a lot of money, and I wish I could get in on that too. And it looks selfish to me. There are other financial innovations that are exciting that I don't hear all. To me, they're exciting. For example, the Benefit Corporation is an idea that's spreading. It's a kind of corporation which is halfway between for-profit and non-profit. Mm-hmm. It's a for-profit corporation that has in its charter a public purpose. So here we're living in a world where we're getting rising inequality, we're getting nationalist separation of, and Bitcoin seems to fit in too much with that. I wish people were less enthusiastic about making money.
You must have consensus that technology should do the good for the whole human being. I think that it's too philosophical, so it's time for us to open the floor for questions. We collect all the questions. We collect all the questions, and we will ask panelists to answer them together. Please, the gentleman, please identify who you are, and please be very brief.
So, for example, you issue a crypto kron, right? Mm-hmm. And it will mean that people will be able to keep these krons at their own wallets. So the need for custodianship, like what the banks are doing, will diminish. It means that a lot of cash will go out of the banking system, which they will not be able to use. So what macro effect do you think it will have on the whole banking system, and how will it change it?
Yeah, very good questions. And please, yeah. Please, we collect all the questions.
Thank you. Great discussion. I'm a journalist, but I'm asking as an interested individual. You said crypto nation. I like that. If you could start again from scratch tomorrow with a failed state or some country X, would you make it a crypto nation?
Good question.
Which panelists do you want them to respond to you? Okay, all of them. Great. Yeah, we collect all the questions, please. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, Winston Ma from CIC, China Investment Corporation. And a question to Professor. Since Professor Yu gave CIC a speech, right, a few months ago, and focus was more on behavior finance, I was very curious. You haven't touched on it. Maybe take the chance from your behavior finance perspective to comment on this.
Because of limited time, please be brave. Please. Thank you. Please.
Hi, I'm a journalist from Holland. One issue that has not been discussed is Bitcoin's energy use, which seems to be hanging over the whole crypto world as a dark cloud, rising up to levels of maybe entire countries. I'm especially interested in the Bitcoin fans' perspective on that.
Yeah. Liwei.
I'm Li Wei from Caixin. I want to build on Professor Schiller's point to challenge.
You have no time to build.
Yeah.
You only have time to ask questions.
So for yourself, if a Bitcoin enthusiast do this, view this as an asset, it's okay. But if given nowadays inequality, the need to do money laundering, and people's distrust of the government, everyone will just pile in. Say China crack this down. These people will go to South Korea or Japan. And then when there is an eventual, if central bank do not act, there is an eventual crack kind of fall. And then all the people, Korean, have go on the street to protest. So I'm just wondering, this is not a steady state. Central bank have to go in before kind of this become a systematic risk.
You mean the CBDC or the regulation?
Regulation. But CBDC can help.
Do you have questions? A comment. Good. Very good. Thank you.
So just challenge the view of the.
Okay, and Ali.
With ETA Media Group, my question for Ms. Governor is that, do you think it is possible or necessary or feasible for us to do some global coordination in terms of regulating Bitcoin or the crypto asset? And I'm very sure another question is that, do you think a next financial crisis may be caused by crypto asset because a lot of investment banks like Goldman Sachs are now testing waters to provide brokerage service in terms of Bitcoin futures? Thank you.
Very good questions. And I see there is a hands from the gentleman. Yeah. Oh, the lady, please.
Thank you. My name is Jennifer from ScanTrust. This question is actually for Neil. We talked a lot about Bitcoin, but we didn't get a chance to talk about other cryptocurrencies. And as you know, a lot of startups are now raising money, and it's disrupting your venture capital model. So I'm curious to hear whether or not you're going to start investing into the ICOs. How do you feel about that? And what is your strategy going forward?
Yeah, the lady here, please. Yeah, you.
Hi, I'm a crypto newbie, but one of the things my understanding is that the technology protocol behind Bitcoin isn't particularly scalable. And so if the underlying protocol isn't scalable, how do you expect it to sort of do something like become gold or, you know, replace the reserve currency?
Yeah, very good question. And the final one, final two from the gentleman there.
Hi, I'm from Geneva, El Kazen. I was just wondering, the Bitcoin is based on what value? How is it just the demand that makes the price of the Bitcoin? What is the value? How do you scale the value of the Bitcoin?
Okay. Thank you. The final one.
Jeremy Warner, another journalist. It's not part of the problem with Bitcoin as a currency that it can't expand beyond a certain point, and therefore it can't really accommodate economic growth properly, and a bit like when currencies were linked to the gold standard, it would then become deflation.
I think we have solved that problem. You arrive late, I guess. Anyway, I think we have eight or nine questions. So every one of you can pick the questions you like and comment on that. Maybe Neil from you.
Okay. So I'll comment first on the crypto nation. If you're a failed state, what have you got to lose? Mm. I don't see why you could actually do. So I don't think you'd print paper currency. You might do a central bank controlled digital currency, or you could do something that was distributed in terms of control, and you might attract a lot of business and citizens. So I would definitely try that. The other one I wanted to comment on was the question about whether this disrupts the venture capital model. I don't think it does as dramatically as you might think. I think that there are still, and I think there will be for quite a while, entrepreneurs who want to sell equity and work with somebody who's aligned with them in the same security to build a company and to share the gain. That doesn't mean that company might not at some point issue tokens, but it doesn't mean that they'll use them as their primary way of raising capital. On the other hand, there are some ICOs that we think could make sense, and we are looking at those carefully.
And also technology, the scalability issue?
Yeah. So, I mean, that kind of reminds me of what people used to say about the internet and about the early days of Ethernet or TCP/IP, that it will never scale.
But shall we wait decades?
These other things. I think we'll get there. I think that these things, entrepreneurs are very resourceful, engineers are very resourceful. And it will scale, or we'll come up with versions of it that will scale better. But you're right, it's not particularly fast, it's not particularly cheap, and it consumes a lot of energy.
Yeah. Jennifer?
I'll try to use one sentence to answer every question. CryptoNation, wow. Definitely, because of Trust Leap. We didn't used to trust a paper note, but now we trust paper note. Now we are, a lot of next generation are digital native, so why would we still go back to pay, you know, build paper money? In terms of energy use, I totally agree. I think Bitcoin is not efficient at all, but again, depends on what you benchmark against, right? If Bitcoin is disrupting gold, compared to gold mining and gold security, and money spent on gold security and transportation, Bitcoin is not that bad. In terms of money laundry, let me answer this question with a question. Before Bitcoin, what did we use for money laundry? So Bitcoin is just a tool. It's not the reason there's money laundry. In terms of global coordination of regulation, I'll leave to the governor to have final say, but I think from my own experience, I think each government, each central bank has its own priority. It will be very hard to achieve a global coordination.
I agree.
In terms of scalability versus being a very effective store of value, scalability is measured by number of transactions per minute. So if you use Bitcoin as payment, the number of transactions per minute matters, right? If you look at Visa, Master. But if you use a store of value, you're not gonna trading every all the time. So because it's disrupting gold and—
So it's not currency.
It's not currency. In terms of Bitcoin, the value, I think a lot of people argue that there's no underlying value, but if Bitcoin can replace even 5% or 10% of as a store of value compared to the global gold reserve, you can do the math that Bitcoin right now is still very undervalued.
So it's adjusted from a belief. The value is from people's
belief.
Same
as gold. Gold right. Price is based on how we
value.
Consensusly.
Yeah. Professor, you have more.
Someone asked for a behavioral finance perspective. So I come back to the idea that Bitcoin is an interesting idea, but it's way over represented in our attention because it's like a speculative bubble. That it involves contagious stories about people making a lot of money. And that you don't like this, but let me go on.
It's not about money.
There are other innovations, there are other things to think about.
I will arrange another event for you to debate for the whole day on that. Yeah. But before that, Professor, would you like to answer the question from the will Bitcoin nurture next financial crisis?
Well, that's the thing about central banks have been perfecting their art for how many years in Sweden?
350 in the Swedish case, yeah. But most are 150.
And I congratulate you. they now think that they have a target inflation rate, and they're pretty much hitting the target. Bitcoin, you said, will be deflationary, maybe massively deflationary. I don't think you have a good feeling about what that will mean for the economy. It seems like it'll be very disruptive to the economy, and we've got a good thing going with you people.
We do our best. Over to me then, and the question from the lady: regulating globally or nationally? I think it's mainly taken care of. It is taken care of on a national basis through investment protector legislation, anti-money laundering protection, etc. Globally, it remains to be seen whether it's going to be regulated or not. Is it a source of new financial crisis? This is. I may have to. Regret this for the rest of my life, but I think no. I don't think this, as we can see it now, to be a source of the next financial crisis, because the sizes and the level of leverage is probably, and it's not within the banking system as we can see it. That probability is pretty low. The consequences from a macroeconomic perspective of keeping central bank digital currency in the wallet next to your notes and coins, next to your debit card where you keep your commercial bank money, it's a very difficult question. There are different research going into different directions. They open up a variety of tricky issues. Let me just finalize by saying that safe and efficient versions of money that are being offered in ways that society needs in order to facilitate transactions in a safe and efficient way that is very beneficial for the economy. I'll stop there.
Yeah, thank you, Governor. I think we have run out of the time, but still I would like to take the privilege of the moderator to ask you very quickly two final questions. The first one is that in 1 year's time, how would you predict the average price level of the Bitcoin? And the second, in 10 years' time, do you think which currency will become the next great global currency? Central banking digital currency of the dollar, CBDC of the euro, CBDC of the RMB, or Bitcoin? Maybe from Governor first.
So as a decision maker in interest rates, I have to make a number of forecasts. Luckily, Bitcoin is not one of them that affects my world as a decision maker. So I will not give you any forecast of what Bitcoin will be. On the question of in 10 years' time, which currency will become the next big global currency, I don't think it will be Bitcoin in terms of sizes and in terms of how well it is sort of used in the economy. And I think it remains truly a very open question whether any central bank have issued a digital version of their own currency addressed to individuals. It's a very open question. But and a lot of us, including the Riksbank, are looking into it.
Professor, very quickly.
I'm glad you set the example for not answering your question. I've discovered that when I give flippant forecasts, they get quoted.
Okay, then the global currency in 10 years' time.
Maybe I can guess this, because it's not as dangerous.
Please.
I'll say the euro.
Euro.
Yeah.
CBDC euro.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, Jennifer?
Back to I don't like the point about it's about money.
It's we still have time.
I want to say this. I actually don't care about where Bitcoin's price is going to be, because the fact that Bitcoin has been survived for so long, it means it's a very powerful idea. I really don't care where it's going to be, and I think
so. You will hold.
I will hold not really, you know, primarily for the profit. I will hold for the idea.
I see.
Secondly,
for the belief.
For the belief and also for the idea, that could inspire a lot of different possibilities and imaginations in our new monetary system.
And in 10 years' time?
In 10 years' time, I still think that, I don't think, you know, crypto currency completely outside of a central bank system will really flourish in the global.
Is it Bitcoin or anyone else, anything else?
No, I think it potentially could be Chinese central bank issued national cryptocurrency that mobilized the trade on One Belt, One Road.
Thank
that
you.
Could be very powerful.
Yeah, Neil.
So none of them answered the question, but I have
Please.
To answer the question.
I'm happy to that.
Great. I'll take the heat for the flippant forecast. I would say that I think...
But very briefly.
Very briefly?
Yeah.
I don't know, 25,000 a year from now. Mm-hmm. Please don't write it down. Mm-hmm. but I would also agree that as long as it's alive and higher than it is today, I think it's a success. I don't care if it's
absolutely.
But to your other question, I think it'll be a digital currency, and you know, your bet is as good as mine. Nobody said the dollar, so why don't we say the digital dollar?
Yeah, thank you so much. Final poll for you: how many of you are against Bitcoin now? Fewer. And how many of you are pro Bitcoin now? Also fewer.
Yes.
Strange. But anyway, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much for our...